And today we come with a topic which sounds very, very simple, very matter of fact. And sometimes people even wonder, what is there to teach about it? What is there to discuss about it? Yeah, we all communicate, don't we? We communicate with our near and dear, with outsiders. Most of us are multilingual, so we communicate in different languages with different people. All that goes on. So what is there to talk about it? So today I thought I'll update you on the significance of communication, right? Anyway, what is communication? Communication is the art or the skill of being understood. I want to convey something to somebody. How do I make the others understand what I want to convey? That is basically communication. And as I said, we take communication for granted because right from childhood, we are taught how to talk, how to, you know, express ourselves. Then we go higher. We are taught about, you know, how to write in proper language. We are taught more than one language. Most of the time we are taught three languages. Then we master at least one or two of them. And we go ahead, sometimes we learn new languages on our own, and that communication sort of goes on. Unless, of course, we land up in a situation where we are in an environment or in a country or place where, you know, we don't speak their language and they don't speak our language. That is when we realize the importance of communication and we say, hey, unless and until I can speak or I can make myself understood, what can I do about it? That is what communication is all about, right? So what we look at in communication, so much taken for granted. Let me take you back into the earliest history. Mankind, man was a caveman and was, I suppose, more or less equal to all the other animals, and in certain ways not equal because there were many animals which are bigger, stronger, and have greater force of strength to get what they want. So man was definitely not a great being who could have conquered the others, starting right from the age of the dinosaurs and all that, which were massive, and then going on to the age where there were lions and tigers and elephants and cheetahs and gorillas and so many animals who are physically speaking superior to us. Then what made us progress from being the caveman to the modern people that we are today, where we are the supposedly superior race? We control the planet and we control all the other living beings who are much stronger than us. The basic thing is communication. When we started to learn how to communicate, we have these throats which are a little more flexible than others. So that's the reason why when I talk to you, I can take out so many different sounds which convert into different words, and those words form sentences, and thereby I am in a position to convey in detail to you. And when you listen to me and you want to convey something, you put it on the chat box, and there you are, you know, through the written word, even without saying anything verbally, you are able to convey. Like right now, I can see so many people saying good afternoon and wishing everybody and all that. So you're conveying that to us because you have that ability to be able to, you know, use the written word and convey to us. So all these advantages that we have taken them for granted. And one of the things that we really take for granted, and we should do something about it, is the ability to listen. In fact, very often I tell people that let us start spelling communication as L-I-S-T-E-N. It is amazing. The more we listen to others, the better we understand and we can communicate better to them. But we don't understand that. So many of us only want to express what we want to say. We do not have the patience to listen to the other person. And when we do listen also, we sort of, you know, criticize or cut it short because we do not agree with that person. And that is what hampers communication. All those of you who have been through, you know, Banjara's courses or DCS and all that, you understand that we have this skill called empathy to be able to understand what is going on in the mind of the other person. Why does a person behave in a particular way? Why does a person express certain things? All this is such a fantastic skill. And by now you also know that whatever people say and communicate is based on their emotions. At that moment, if the person is feeling friendly, or the person is feeling angry, or the person is feeling jealous, or the person is feeling excited, depending on that, he says whatever he wants to and he communicates whatever he wants to. Now, communication is the first step or the foundation of building relationships. It builds that bridges between people. So many other living beings, they do not have the power of communication as we have. And we should be so fortunate and so thankful for that, because many don't have. On the other hand, if you have noticed, among all the living beings, those who do have good communication manage to lead a better quality of life. Take a simple animal or insect like an ant. The way they communicate with each other. One ant is exploring somewhere around and finds that there is some food particles. He can enjoy himself. He can eat as much as he wants sitting there. He doesn't do that. He immediately goes back and informs his people that at such and such place, there is food available. And he conveys to them how to reach there. And those people start off. They form a line and they all go there. And they pick up one morsel of that food, the size that they can carry, and they go back. And while going back, if you have noticed, there's one line of ants going up and one line of ants coming down. They stop and sort of touch each other. We don't know what that touch is, but obviously they are communicating something to them. They are telling them that there is more food available, so go ahead or whatever it is. Because as soon as the food is over, you'll see there are no more ants coming. Ants are not just coming and hunting around and looking. The moment that food particles are over, the line of the ants disappears. And then what we don't see, the ants go inside, store it in a particular place, keep it so that when there is a need, they will be able to eat, and they have stored up enough so that they know that whatever happens, supposing they are living in a place where there's extreme climate, supposing there is snow, the snow covers the anthill and they can't even get out, but they don't starve because they have made all this trouble of finding, storing and keeping enough food for themselves. I'm giving you this example to help you understand the significance of communication. That we, the human beings who have so much more, we can, you know, lead a better quality of life. We can have better relationships because of communication. And as I keep reminding you, relationships are the one single factor which contribute to a person's happiness, fulfillment. Right? Okay. So let us start with, you know, there are different, purposes of communication. When I communicate, it could be for one of so many different reasons. If I'm aware of why I'm communicating, it helps me to communicate better. So what is the purpose of my communication? Is it to inform somebody about something? Is it to convince somebody that I am right and he should follow what I am saying? Is it to inspire and provoke thoughts in that person so that that person starts thinking about it? Is it to impress the person how much I know? Or is it just to entertain that person, make him happy? There are some more. To empower and build skills. To defend yourself so that somebody else is saying something and I want to defend and correct the wrongs which other people are thinking about me. Is it to preach to help people to, you know, understand certain philosophies which I believe in? And is it to build better relationships? So, people, to pass time fruitfully also, you know, people just get together and they just keep gossiping or chatting just to pass time fruitfully. There are so many different reasons why I communicate with somebody else. The only thing is, if I'm clear on my purpose of communication, then I'm far more effective. A person who wants to entertain, he should be witty, he should be humorous, he should have a style of talking which attracts attention, and he can go on and on and on entertaining people for hours. But at the end of it, has anything worthwhile been conveyed? Has the other person been informed of something? Has his knowledge increased? No. And vice versa. Supposing I want to convey something which is very important. I want to convince a person that this is there. Then whether I'm entertaining or not, whether I'm lively or not, I can express it in such a way that the person gets convinced about what I am, you know, saying. To be able to do that, we should also understand one very simple thing. Communication is a cycle. Just because I have spoken something, this I have seen very often. I've already told so-and-so about this. I've already conveyed this to somebody. But that other one said, no, you've not conveyed. You've not told me this. Now, who is truthful and who is lying? To be able to understand that, we should be clear on what I call as this cycle of communication. So here you will see the communication, what it consists of. We start with the formulation of thought. First, I think what I want to convey. So I put it in words, I put it in something else. I make it like a, you know, PowerPoint presentation as I have done here so that I can be more effective. So that's my first duty, that I must formulate my thoughts, be clear on what I want to convey. Then the language in which it is spoken. What is the type of language that I will use? Should I use bombastic language? Should I use simple language? Should I convey in English or should I convey in mother tongue? All this plays a very important role. Which type of language, which type of words the other person will understand? Once that is done, I have to be aware of the echo and the disturbances. This is something we don't give enough thought to. The other person is busy talking to somebody, or there are too many sounds or noises or something coming. When that is coming, my communication, which I have thought of very well, I formulated it into a good language, but because of the echo disturbances, the other person doesn't understand. It doesn't grasp. And once that is done, then receiving the message and feedback. The feedback completes the cycle. So unless and until you observe the person and the person nods his head or the person says, yes, you are right. Okay, I have got it. or maybe sometimes even question you, what exactly did you mean by this, clarifies, then you know that the communication cycle is complete. So what I always recommend is, whenever you want to communicate something which is important, please make sure that you prepare well. Preparation, formulation of thought, formulation of what type of language I'm going to convey this. Will this particular communication be better if I tell on the phone? Or should I take the trouble of going and meeting the person and conveying it to him or her? Is it better for me to make some written notes and then give it to the person? All these things we need to sit and think whenever there is an important communication to be conveyed. And here comes another important thing, the receiver. What is the receiver going to think? There may be a receiver who is very, very knowledgeable, and what you are telling he already knows. So he won't bother. He will say, hey, what is this? He is telling me something which I already know. And his mind gets distracted into something else. Vice versa, you're telling something to somebody who is not knowledgeable about the subject at all. And when you're telling this, the person is getting lost. This you can see even happens in studies in the classrooms. There are some children who are slow learners. They fall behind. And the moment they fall behind and the teacher goes ahead, they lose interest because they are not grasping, they are falling behind and they are not able to see the continuity. And then that child is blamed, saying that the child is not interested, the child is not studying. From there it starts and goes on to the corporate world and family life, everything. A person is very, very worried about something. And here you are talking about a completely different subject. The person may not be in a mood to listen to you. One more very important thing to remember is that communication, 55% of communication is visual. It is what you show, your expressions, the way you are conveying. And 37-38% is the tone of your language. It's just 8% which is the text. So if you understand your own body language, similarly, if you can become an expert in deciphering the other person's body language, looking carefully at the person, looking at the expression, looking at the way he or she is standing, moving, how the tone goes up and down, all this can help you to understand the other person much, much better. Similarly, there's a very good proverb which I always tell people, that when you are conveying, when you are talking to somebody, those people will not remember what you said. People will not remember what you said. They will not even remember what you did, but they will remember what you made them feel. Everything boils down to feelings and emotions. You will find people saying, he came and said something to me, I don't know, but I got very angry, I got very upset. The way he was behaving, I felt that, no, he doesn't give any importance to me. So please remember this very, very important thing. And when this happens, when you have to have certain amount of some criticism or some, confrontation, please do it by the sandwich method. Please make sure that you are telling the person in the right, proper, manner. I was telling you about the tone of the, thinking. Just have a look at this slide, you'll get an idea about what I mean. If you are saying a simple sentence, prepare well, take a deep breath. then understand the receiver as much as you can. Understand that nonverbal body language tone consists of 55% plus 37%. These simple things you will understand, create. Now, despite all that, if there is criticism or confrontation required, what do? The sandwich method, as we call it. Say something nice, then do the criticism, and then again come back to being nice. When there is a breakdown, when some spouse, friend, somebody is not talking to each other, how do you build back that communication? In fact, 2-3 weeks from now, I'm going to do a separate session on, you know, rebuilding communication where communication has broken down. That also happens. And then we are at a loss. Benefit of keeping communication continued regardless of whether you like the person or not. Are you keeping your communication continued? You get to know even people who are your so-called enemies. You should have communication with them to know what's going on in their mind. The question arises, is it better to be right or better to be happy? You want to be happy, isn't it? So even if you prove yourself right, but you're not happy, what does it mean? When there is no communication, there are always suspicions and doubts. Remember that. The moment you cut off communication, there are other inputs that the person is getting, and those inputs are making the person form wrong impression about you. And that's why I told you, people will not remember what you said. They will not remember what you did, but they will remember what you made them feel. That is what you have to keep in mind whenever you are doing any serious or any important communication. Now, the point here is that we need to constantly practice and build up our communication. We need to keep improving, and the best way of doing it is by observing people. As I told you, I interact with somebody, I say something, I did something. In the end, what did I leave that person feeling? That is important to me. If that person feels upset about what I said, feels angry with what I said, then I failed in my communication. So I need to, from time to time, observe, analyze, and understand what my communication has achieved. The same way, I need to be a good observer of the other person's communication. Is the person communicating that, from what purpose? What is his, you know, idea in communicating with me? What are the thoughts and feelings going on in his mind? Is he congruent? Is he actually saying what he feels? Or is he a hypocrite? He's just trying to say something, whereas he feels something very differently. These are the things which will make a difference and which will make, you know, the communication much, much more effective and much more, And in today's world, where everything on communication has turned electronic, I can tell you with confidence, there is nothing like face-to-face communication. Face-to-face communication always has a greater impact than any form of electronic communication. I'm not against electronics. I'm not against, you know, technology and all that. Yes, it helps us to communicate a lot. But whenever possible, if you can have face-to-face communication, you will find that it makes a world's difference. And that is something that we have been aiming towards, along with our basic thrust towards counseling. We also believe that communication is a very important thing. So in different ways, whether it is for children or teenagers, whether it's for adults, we keep doing different types of activities, programs to enhance and make people understand and do better communication. In fact, Purni has been working a lot on all these aspects. So I invited her today to share with you, you know, how communication can be improved and enhanced and what we are doing about it. And we would like to have your inputs also on how to do it. So here is Purni for you.
So Purni returns. Good afternoon to all of you all. Good to see that week after week you have questions, you watch the listen to the talk, and you wait till your questions have been answered to your satisfaction. That's really wonderful. So as Ali was telling, and as befitting this topic is also, see, what we have also been doing is we see our so many of our students and people who visit us for various services, what they all end up telling is that, ma'am, one-to-one, you know, I can do things. I have no problem if it is one-to-one. I get problem only when I have to speak to, you know, few people around. They may be known, they may be strangers, or I may be in a new crowd, and then if my husband or my brother, they end up telling me, why are you not talking? You seem like a, you know, proud person and things like that. But it's actually not that. They feel little not confident to be speaking. So that's why what we do is that, you know, keeping that in mind, we have evolved a program which has been going on for years now, which is called Certificate in Presentation and Communication Skills. Okay. So now when these people, you know, they feel so hesitant, and it's not that they don't have content. They have content. They have good intentions. They have good thoughts to share, but it's only that little butterflies in your stomach, as you call, and knots in your stomach when you have to just stand up and speak before, you know, even 5-10 people, leave alone, you know, hundreds of them. And then we know that they really have, you know, quality in what they want to say, but purely because of their little hesitation or not having the courage to speak, that, you know, they end up just holding themselves back. So what we thought is that there's a very nice course which is called, as I just mentioned, a Certificate in Presentation and Communication Skills. So what we have done is we have, say, around some 30 odd topics. Okay. So you can choose your audience, whether it's school children, their office goers, teachers, women, adolescents, you can choose. And the topics also can be chosen which you think you may need for your presentations. Okay. I'll give you an example. It can be a topic, say, like team building, or it can be a topic like assertive communication, speaking without hurting, or bullying, or it can be tantrums. It can be sibling rivalry. So like this, there can be a lot of different topics which, you know, one can get practice in, and you can choose also. I'm going to, these are like my office goer crowds. And what methods? Methods are icebreakers. Icebreakers are which just defreeze you, know. You're just seeing a crowd, and then you're like, new crowd, you're twiddling your thumb, you're waiting. Should I speak to her, not speak to her? I don't know. And some people are a little wary. Some people are like, you know, holding themselves strong. So a lot of things happen. And you just have to disarm them. So that's where icebreakers come in. You do some small, quick 5 minutes activity. There's a little bit of a loosening. You feel a little silly doing something. Then you feel happy doing something. Or then you may look left and right before you do the right thing. So these are all icebreaker activities. Then there might be team activities. Team activities as in, if there are 30 of them, you're 6, 6, 6, 6 in a group. And then you give them one topic and then they start doing that. So when we are observing them, you understand that what role this person likes to play. Yeah, likes to lead, likes to be a good team member, likes to add content, likes to add, what do you say, paraphernalia, some nice fashion material. They like to do that very well. Like that, it comes up. So each one keeps doing different things. Then there are games, there are quizzes, there are puzzles, questionnaires, even showing movie clippings, no? That also is a part of a good presentation and communication skill. So we used to have our little children who used to do these life skills camps called Blossoms. So what we used to do is how to show that accept yourself. The inner is important, not the outer. Okay. There is a movie called Shrek. S-H-R-E-K. Anish will just write down for you. S-H-R-E-K. If you get an opportunity, make children watch it and you also watch it. That man, the hero, does not look any way charming or tall, dark, handsome, nothing at all. But he's so good from the inside. So when you show small movie clippings from that, that also becomes a part of your communicating your thoughts, your ideas. So this whole course, we just thought, we should get this out. And that is what the students are going to be, learning now. Maybe just possibly two, three weeks down the line, we are going to have. It's called CPCS. So we have courses A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and a lot of courses we have. This one coming up is CPCS. Yeah. Yes, Sridevi said that Shrek was such a great movie. So look at it. Even there are different methods how you can communicate. And this one surely will help you to, reach out to more people than one. See, one-to-one, you are comfortable. You'll make the other person speak and all that happened. That is good enough. Perfect. But when you are in a group, you may feel left out or you may want to contribute. They will ask you for something. And if you're fumbling, then you don't feel good about it yourself, no? So that is our humble contribution through CPCS. And of course, we actually have got a very good response for our diploma in counseling skills. You all know about it. And for those who don't know, diploma in counseling skills is a one-year part-time program. And we are getting so many inquiries. Some days we are really houseful with calls and people. And as our mark of respecting and celebrating women, we have a Women's Day offer, you can say. I don't like to call it offer, but our gratitude for women. That is for men also, okay? Because there is so much we women learn from you men. So all this is on. And that's about us from this side. And from your side, let all the questions keep pouring in. And all the answers will pour out from Ali. Yes, and thank you so much. And a big good afternoon to all those who have told me. So group, good afternoon to each one of you. Have a lovely day and a good weekend. I'll see you soon.
Yes, I'm back. And after all the interactions with Purni and your comments with Purni, I now see questions coming up, starting with Vinita. Hi, Ali. I totally agree that how we talk is important than what we are talking. Sometimes I just switch off if the other person is not talking in a right tone. And as you said in your classes, communication is the key to any relationship. Yes, somebody is not talking in the right tone. The person is saying the right words, but the person is not talking in the right tone. And that itself can put us off so badly that we don't even want to listen. We don't want to give a chance to that person. That is how it, happens. In fact, somebody even said that most of the wars that start in different countries start with a wrong tone of speech. One king or one president or whatever it is says something in a nasty manner to the other person, and that person takes offense, and from there it starts off and it leads even to wars. Surekha says, this husband is very dominating in conversations and wants to grab the spotlight all the time. The wife is feeling very suffocated and restricted. How should she communicate her displeasure when he doesn't allow her to talk at all and shuts her down the moment she opens her mouth? Now here we take advantage of the other means of communication. Maybe she can write a chit and give it to him, saying that there are times when I, not criticizing him, not saying that you are dominating and all that, but there are times when I want to convey and I feel I don't get that opportunity. Will you allow me next time to come across with my opinions also? And that can be done electronically, that can be done through a WhatsApp message or whatever it is. That could be the first step. If the person is still not obliging, that means he has a strong need to dominate. He wants to somehow show to his wife that I am this great person and I am right and all that. It could be possibly an ego problem. Now, if that is the case, as I mentioned earlier also when we spoke about ego, pamper is ego. When he says something, instead of trying to get your opinion and try to cover up and give some different views or whatever you want to do, actually praise him. Oh, you're so great. You know this, you know that. The more you do that, the more the person starts feeling that, yes, I am being recognized. I am being acknowledged. And that is when you slowly start turning around and starting with your own thing. One classic example of this was given in that serial which used to come, Yes, Minister. The secretary always used to say yes to the minister, never say no. So somehow I feel that if there is an ego problem and that is the reason why he wanted to dominate, then the wife can use that technique if it is necessary. Lastly, if nothing works, then the wife should start shutting off when this man is into a monologue by saying, sorry, I don't agree with you. You can say whatever you want. Be there, give a blank look to the person, make it very clear that I am no longer interested in communicating with you. These are different ways. You don't know which one will work, right? Then Surekha says, this wife is refusing to accept her adultery. That means she's had an affair. And the husband, despite evidence to the contrary, is willing to forgive only if he has a confession from her. So he says, you confess that you had this affair, I will forgive and we can move on. But she insists that she is only fond of this person and hasn't got intimate with him. The conflict is escalating and no communication is happening. What should he say? See, here the ball is in the court of the wife, not the husband. He has done whatever he wants to. He has conveyed that if you convey, if you confess, I'm willing to forgive you. But for whatever reason, she is adamant. Now, since there is no communication, the husband has to take a call. You remember when I was sharing the slides, I also mentioned, is it more important for you to be right or is it more important for you to be happy? Now, he knows he's right. Somehow he has evidence or whatever it is that she has been intimate with another man, but she's refusing to give. Now, he has to take a call to ask himself, should I agree? Ignore and say, okay, let's forget about this. Let's move on and let's have this. Or is it very important for him to say, okay, if that is the case, then I'm cutting out. So very, very important. It's a husband and wife relationship. It's a lifelong relationship. But if the wife is so adamant, he has tried all his means, if he has probably tried through a counselor or through some third persons, and if she's still not accepting, then I think he has to take a call. Does he want to be, magnanimous in giving up and not insisting that she should confess, knowing fully well that she has done this, and yet I am going to go ahead with my relationship. Yeah, I've already seen that. Sridevi says, sometimes there is a big gap between what we want to say and what we actually say. As we worry about how it will be perceived, to bridge this gap, the insights of this session has been very useful. Thanks a lot, Sridevi. This is the whole idea, that we have something to say, we want to convey, but we are scared, we don't know whether we'll do it in the right way or not, and that is what prevents us. And when we hold back because of such a fear, then things can go worse and worse. So you learn these basic techniques. Today what I am conveying is just the top tip of the iceberg. There's so much in communication. In fact, I've written a workbook on communication also. If anybody interested, they can pick up either the hard copy or the soft copy by contacting the office. Venu will send it to you. You can buy a copy of that communication book and practice so many things so that tomorrow, if you are facing a situation like this where you are afraid that you will be misunderstood or you will not be able to convey properly, you can learn these techniques. It's not difficult at all. Shobha says, how can I communicate with a person who has ill feelings towards me? Two things. One is to try and find out what those ill feelings are and why they came up. Is it because I did something? Is it because that person expected something from me which I could not fulfill? Whatever. Once, if you can find out why that ill feeling is, ask yourself whether I want to do something about it and whether I want to change or not. On the other hand, if the communication is so bad that you can't even find out why that ill feeling is there, the person is just being nasty to you or ignoring you and doesn't seem to be having any specific reason, you're not able to find that out, then you use the basic simple things like either putting something in writing and conveying to the person that I'm your friend, I do care for you, I want to have a good relationship with you. Please tell me if there is something that needs to be done. Trying it out through a third person, somebody whom this person respects and has a good feeling towards. Let that person talk and find out what is happening. When all this fails, then I feel that it is better to let go of such a person. You have so many other good people in your life. Ignore that one person and build your relationship with the other people. Madhvi says, hi Ali, I saw you are a big listener. Listening beautiful song, enjoying most, a lot of learning from meaningful songs. We had the best communicator, Amin Sani. Yes, he just passed away. For 40, 50 years, he was an amazing person. Amin Sani, in those good old days when TV and all that was not there, it is said, it's amazing, they said that approximately 60% of India used to listen to him. And 60% of India does not speak Hindi. The very fact that even people who are not Hindi speaking, they used to listen to his programs, it shows what an amazing person he was. And yes, you're right. His best example, if I learn 1%, I feel I am blessed. There's so many things about him, the way he used to do that. There was a time when somebody said that, you always start your program with Bhaiyo or Behno. He said, no, you've forgotten. Please check. I never start my program with Bhaiyo or Behno. I always start my program with Behno or Bhaiyo. I give the ladies first thing. Small touches like that. I'm sure there are millions of women who felt touched by that statement of his. He was a living legend. We really are going to miss him. Surekha says, when somebody shows repeated indifference to your efforts to connect with this loved one, how should the person communicate his displeasure? I just was answering to Shobha also something very similar, Surekha, that make your efforts, try different ways. That is something. Don't keep on trying the same way. Don't keep on trying to communicate it to the same person in the same manner. Try it out in writing, try it out in different ways, try it out through different people, try it out sometimes, when you're sitting in a group and you convey so that that person is conscious that others are also listening and the person may feel a little more you know, compelled to listen to you. So once you've tried out all that, I still feel that whatever may be your relationship with that person, once you've tried everything under the sun and you're sure that you have not left any stone unturned, then I think it is better to give up and focus on other relationship. I'm not saying give up in the sense stop talking or behave like a child, but just stop communicating anything worthwhile to that person or having any expectations from that person. Shova says, thank you. Yes. Thanks, Shova. Sharayu says, good reading habit makes one good communicator since we can connect. Absolutely right, Sharayu. This is something which I go on and on and on saying, please do not give up your reading habit. More and more people I feel are turning towards the visual thing. They want to watch 2-minute reels. They don't want to read a 100-page book. They don't want to read even a, you know, a 1,000-word article in the newspaper. But the fact remains that there is so much to learn from reading. It builds our vocabulary. It helps us to communicate better. It builds a better, deeper understanding. So this is my continuous request to all of you. Whatever else you do, please do not give up your reading habit. Read as much as you can. As I mentioned, it could be a newspaper, it could be a book or a booklet which you keep by your bedside and read whenever you have the time. All these factors play a very, very significant role. Work on these things, improve your communication, and understand that communication builds better relationships. And relationships are the one single factor that, you know, decides about your quality of life. Forget about the other person's. It improves and enriches your quality of life. So that is our simple message. Please do practice some of the things which I've already told you through the slides. Get back to me if there's anything that you feel personally or you'd like to, you know, clarify or improve further upon. Like I said, you can pick up that communication book and go through it if you want to practice further on improving your communication. So with that, I sign off today's program. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.